Good evening. Please take a seat. We are about to start today's lecture. So first I'll introduce myself. My name is Carlos Duarte and I'm professor in marine science with the Biological and Environmental Science and Technology Division of KAUST. And I have the pleasure to open this session tonight and also introduce later on my two colleagues that will accompany us along a trip around the ocean tonight. So we're going to be sharing with you exploration of innovation and discovery, and also share with you our passion about the ocean and why we are now moved into seafaring in the ocean as we did in the past. And the reason why we do that is very clear, but before we move into that, let me again thank Mark Tester, Marie-Laure Bolo, and also all of the web team for the superb web that we've been enjoying over the last 2 weeks. And tomorrow then we come to a grand finale. And this is probably the second day that we discuss oceans during the web, but the oceans are a big component of the planet and a big element and a big focus of sustainability efforts. So therefore it fits very well with the theme of the web. So let me share with you why we are engaged in seafaring in the ocean, and that's very easy. We sail because it's necessary, and Pompey in 56 before Christ, one of the great generals of the Roman Empire, made this sentence, navigare necessite est, vivere non est necesse, which means that we must sail, we must explore, and that's above our own lives. And in fact, sailing started in the Red Sea with the first seagoing vessels built by Egyptians about 6,000 years ago. And since we laid our boats in the ocean, we've been exploring the margins of the ocean, and that's a venture that hasn't finished yet. So once we discovered that the Earth is not flat and it doesn't have rough edges over which we may fall, and in fact is round, then we thought that we can go around through the ocean. And the first circumnavigation, which goal was to open global trade, happened in the 16th century, about 500 years ago, led by Magellan and Elcano, serving the Spanish crown on board four research vessels, Trinidad, that was the flagship, Victoria, San Antonio, Concepcion, and Santiago. Only Victoria arrived back home, and Magellan died in the Philippines. So only a small contingent made it back, but the goal was to open a commercial route to the islands of the species, the Moluccans, for the Kingdom of Spain. So soon after this circumnavigation was completed, Francis Drake also sailed around the Earth for the British, the England crown on board the Pelican, and the ship was refurbished and changed name to the Golden Hind. And the goal was to challenge the trade routes that had been opened by the Spanish crown. So circumnavigations to gain control of commercial routes went on for about 200 years. And then in the Lightning, the goals of circumnavigation shifted. And all of a sudden, the goals were no longer to take control of commercial routes or warfare, but the goals were to learn more about the planet we inhabit. And certainly the champion of circumnavigations is James Cook, who completed two circumnavigations on board Endeavour, the first one, and the second one on board Resolution, and actually died on the third circumnavigation. And this circumnavigation is important because it's the first one that was entirely driven by scientific goals. And it was funded by the Royal Society, and the goal was to conduct multidisciplinary science. And at the same time, there were two other major circumnavigation expeditions, one led by Jean-François de la Pérouse for the Crown of France between 1770 and 1780 on board the vessels Boussole and Astrolabe. And the goal again was to do multidisciplinary research about our planet, and also some political goals in terms of exploring the domains that were claimed to the French crown. But this one expedition was lost at sea, and they never came back to France. And the third one that I like to highlight, and relates to one of the expeditions we're going to talk about tonight, is that led by Alejandro Malaspina, who was an Italian Navy man and also a scientist who sailed on board Atrevida and Descubierta, two vessels for the Spanish Crown, again with multidisciplinary research goals and again some political goals to explore the resources in the Spanish Crown, which at the time extended all around the Pacific and the Atlantic to Spain. So again, the goal shifted and it was about learning more about our planet. And these were followed by many other expeditions using more advanced techniques and more modern tools. And then you would think that probably by the end of the 20th century, now that we've developed satellites, all kinds of instruments and autonomous vehicles that can explore the oceans for us, there is no longer a need to engage in seafaring like many of our antecessors did. So this is actually not true, and in fact there's been a renaissance of circumnavigation expeditions in the 21st century. So I'll give you just a glimpse of some of them. So the first one is the Galatea expedition. That was a Danish expedition sailing the ocean with the goals of conducting interdisciplinary research and also promote scientific vocations among the young. Also the Global Ocean Sampling Expedition by Craig Venter, that was led by the Craig Venter Oceanographic Institute on board his own sailboat, the Sorcerer II. And this was the first effort at looking at microbial diversity in the ocean using the modern tools of genomics. And a fourth one that we can highlight is the Blue Earth Global Expedition, or Beagle, conducted on board the Mirai, a Japanese research vessel, all along the Southern Hemisphere. And the goals were to evaluate climate change in the Southern Hemisphere and to train young scientists. But the reason why we're driven to conduct again circumnavigation cruises in the 21st century is first because the advance in understanding the oceans has been far too slow, frustratingly slow, and for many regions of the oceans like the deep sea, by the end of last century we could count with maybe one hand the number of samples that have been taken. And for instance, there's been about three times more people that have laid food on the moon that have been in the deepest spot in our own ocean. And yet we seem to be accepting the idea that we're going to do away without our planet, and we are now looking into exploring planets in other galaxies. We are looking for oceans elsewhere, and we haven't yet done a reasonable effort to explore our ocean and gauge the health of our own ocean. So I would like to share with you tonight three expeditions that are sailing the oceans or have sailed the ocean recently and are driven by some common goals. So this, one of them is the Malaspina expedition, of which I serve as coordinator. And the second one is Tara Oceans. That is an expedition that was led by French scientists, but all of them involved an international consortium of scientists. And the third one is Race for Water. And at that point, I'd like to introduce also my colleagues that are going to brief you on these other two expeditions. So Tara Oceans was led and coordinated by Eric Karsensky. So Eric Karsensky received a PhD in cell biology at the Pasteur Institute in Paris, and then he completed a postdoc at the University of California in San Francisco on cell cycle and mitosis, and then moved on to the European Molecular Biology Lab in Heidelberg, where he led the cell biology and biophysics lab, which was a new interdisciplinary hub. And in 2009, then he took a step that was very different from the research he had been doing before, and then developed and led the Tara Oceans expedition. He continues to sail the ocean, but now exclusively for fun, because he just retired. But just before retirement, his contributions were honored with Eric receiving the Gold Medal of the CNRS in 2015 for his career contributions to cell biology and the Tara Oceans expedition and their contribution to understanding and exploring the oceans. So the Race for Water is another expedition that was initiated in Switzerland. which is a landlocked country, but again, participating also in this joint venture of exploring the ocean. And tonight we have the pleasure to have with us Francis Baldvogel, who is a member of the strategic board of the Race for Water expedition. So Francis was trained as a physician in Geneva and Paris, and he conducted postgraduate work at Harvard Clinical Microbiology Lab, and he became a professor of and chairman of medicine in the University of Geneva, and moved on to become vice president of the Swiss Science Council, where he served for a number of years, and then was asked to chair the Swiss Polytech Institutes for about 10 years. And from that position, he moved on to chair the Novartis Venture Fund that looked into starting up new companies on the biotech and the pharma sector. And after retirement, he has also become interested in exploring the oceans and promoting the sustainable use of the ocean, and has become then a member of the strategic board of Race for Water. So we're going to give you a glimpse about each of these three expeditions. And I will start with the Malaspina expedition and then give the floor to my colleagues to introduce the other two. So there's some reasons why we have chosen these three, and there's some minimum common denominators. One of them is that we're driven by the aim to explore, to innovate, and to discover. The second one is that we share some common scientific goals, like to explore the diversity of microbes and plankton organisms in the ocean. We're going to talk a bit more about what plankton is and the diversity of forms of plankton and why they are important. Also, the interest in using the modern tools of genomics to explore the diversity of life in the ocean. And we all three are particularly concerned by one impact of humans on the ocean, which is marine plastic pollution. So all three expeditions are partnering to address the issue of marine plastic pollution and be able to better understand what is the impact of plastics in the ocean, what is the fate of those plastics in the ocean, and how can we mitigate those impacts by controlling plastic pollution at the consumer level. And also we are driven by an aim to share our knowledge and understanding of the ocean and this exploration with society through an effort to outreach and education of particularly young scientists. And also we share some partner institutes, for instance, KAUST is a partner both in Malaspina and Tara Oceans, and we are now looking at ways of engaging with Race for Water, also to contribute to their research goals. And we also have a number of scientists who participate in all three expeditions. So it makes sense that we work together and that we present these three expeditions together. And you will see that they are very diverse in the way they are conducted, but they converge in these elements that I highlighted. So the Malaspina 2010 circumnavigation expedition that I led had two overarching goals. One, to provide a baseline on the status of and pressures upon the ocean in the 21st century. The second one, to explore marine biodiversity and the functioning of the ocean with an emphasis on the deep sea ecosystem, where for many of the measurements we were conducting, this is the first time that those measurements were conducted in the deep ocean. And also we had another goal, which was historical, and was to assess the impacts of the legacy of the Alejandro Malaspina expedition on the different territories that they visited. We also were motivated with goals of outreach to society and also to educate a new generation of scientists. So the goals were to inform society on the status of the ocean, to promote public interest of science, and promote scientific vocations among the young and train a new generation of marine researchers. And we also wanted to shift the culture of interactions in the Spanish research community from one overly focused on competitive interactions to a culture of cooperation and collaboration, and also develop leadership in marine sciences. So all in all, we had 40 institutions that were participating, including KAUST, from 18 different nations. And now in KAUST, we have three of the seven leaders of the Malaspina expedition, including Professor Xavier Irigoyen, director of the Red Sea Research Center, and Professor Susana Agustí, also with the Red Sea Research Center, and myself. So we have also moved quite significant leadership of the Malaspina expedition to KAUST, and that makes sense that we talk about this project also tonight. And at this point, I need to acknowledge my colleagues that contributed to the expedition, but to do so, I will need to scroll 22 pages of this type of text to get the complete list of contributors. But let's just highlight a particular contingent of contributors, which were the students that will be in training the expedition. So thus far, there's been 84 theses that have been defended based on the work of the Malaspina expedition, 29 master theses, and 55 PhD theses, and we probably will overpass the 100 theses developed in the framework of the expedition. So it wasn't really easy to plan this expedition. It took a lot of time, first to get the funding, to get the resources, and then to plan the expedition. So it took 4 years to design the expedition, but eventually on the 15th of December of 2010, we took sail and initiated the circumnavigation and the voyage that will take us around the world. We were actually sailing with two vessels, the Hesperides, which is a vessel of the Spanish Navy. It's about 90 meters in length and carries about 80 people on board. And the Sarmiento de Gamboa, which is also an oceanic class vessel of about 70 meters long, that was conducting a particular study in the Atlantic and was being used as a floating university to train students on advanced ocean techniques. And Hesperides is the vessel that completed the circumnavigation, and that was the track we followed, and eventually going back to Spain after 7 months. And the area we covered was particularly designed to encompass the subtropical ocean and the large gyres, the central areas of the tropical ocean, the subtropical ocean, that represent about 75% of the ocean surface, but have been largely unexplored. So many of the measurements we took, not only in the deep sea, but also in the surface water, were the first measurements of that kind taken, for instance, in the Indian Ocean and some of these gyres. So I'd like to share with you a little bit of how the expedition developed. And I'd like to share with you a day at sea, one of 400 days. So we were sailing at about 12 knots, which is about 20 kilometers per hour, which is about the regular speed of research vessels. And we were stopping at about 3 in the morning and starting the sampling operations at whatever point we were. And we will use this instrument called a Rosette sampling system that has a number of bottles that can be closed from the research vessel and are loaded with a lot of sensors and instruments that we can monitor as this instrument descends the ocean from on board the vessel. So we then decide where we close the bottles and take samples and bring the instrument up. And it was loaded up here with some acoustic sensors because as we were profiling the acoustic properties of the ocean and sensing fish biomass and plankton with our acoustic detectors mounted in the vessel, we could only reach down to about 400 meters. And with the echo sounder mounted in the Rosette, we could go down to 4,000 meters. So it takes about 4 hours to collect a sample and retrieve the instrument. And we also then, when the instrument was on board, then we collected, deployed a number of nets to collect plankton samples for different purposes, for instance, to quantify the loads of pollutants on plankton, also to evaluate the diversity and measure different processes. And we also skimmed the surface of the ocean with something called a Neustone sampling system, which is this that you see here, and that just skims the first 10 centimeters of the ocean, which is a very important layer for marine life because that's where larvae of organisms and eggs concentrate because of the lipids that they have that confer them buoyancy. And we did that in the very early morning and during midday because the communities changed. While the instruments were deployed in the ocean, then we were also collecting samples from the surface waters, because one of the constraints is that you cannot have more than one long cable deployed in the ocean, because we had a cable with the instrument down to 4,000 meters, and you can imagine that if we deploy another cable, they can be entangled, and then we have a big problem there in the middle of the ocean. So we could only take at the same time surface samples. We also profile the penetration of solar radiation in the ocean, with a particular focus on the penetration of UVB radiation, which has increased in the ocean, particularly in the southern hemisphere where most of the expedition took place, and is now one of the major stressors on marine organisms, the increase in UVB radiation. By this time it was midday, because we only profiled the solar radiation when the sun was above the at the zenith. And then the last operation was the deployment of a series of nets called multi-net, which is an instrument that carries about 8 nets that can be open and closed at different depths. And then we deployed this down to 4,000 meters to sample the plankton organisms and the small fish that live between the surface of the ocean down to 4,000 meters depth. And that took about maybe 2 or 3 hours. Then we were busy at the labs with our samples, and after dinner, every night at 8:30 during 400 days, then we had meetings to discuss the results, to introduce ourselves, because there were many people who didn't know each other and didn't know their background, and also to design experiments based on findings that we were seeing and surprises that we had, that we had also to improvise a lot of experiments. And that seemed to be very smooth and easy, and in fact we designed the expedition to be smooth and easy, but of course when you work at sea sometimes things are not as smooth, and you encounter days where it is not so pleasant to work. But out of the 400 days that the two research vessels operated, we only lost 4 days due to bad weather that we couldn't really take samples. And this particular vessel, Hesperides, I would say that out of the global oceanographic ship is the more operational vessel. So we can work and collect samples under very harsh conditions, but we need to be prudent because we had to complete a circumnavigation. And if we lost the instrument at sea in the first month, then that's it for the project. But as I mentioned, we only lost 4 days. So just to give you some numbers of the expedition, the two vessels together sailed about 42,000 miles, and we collected about 120,000 samples of atmosphere, gases dissolved in seawater, plankton, and other components, dust, and some others. We deboarded with about 6 terabytes of data, and we now have about 7 terabytes of sequencing data we have produced in the lab from the samples we collected. You have seen that there are these winches that that pay cable from which the instruments are suspended. So if we add together all of the cable that these winches paid, so we deployed about 2,000 kilometers of hydrographical cables to sample, and we spent about 3 hours sampling the ocean in each of 313 sampling points in the Indian, Pacific, and Atlantic oceans. And the total number of people involved was about 700, including scientists, students, technicians, crew members, people that were in charge of logistics and administrative support, and also those who were in charge of communication and outreach. So it was a very large international team involved. Right now it's been almost 5 years since the end of the expedition, and by now we have published more than 100 papers. I think we exceeded 100 papers last year, and I'm highlighting here 3 of them published in Science. But this is only about 15% of the results. And of course I don't have time to walk you through all of the results reported in these papers, but I'd like to share with you a glimpse of the results. And I'm going to do that starting from measurements and results that we have from the atmosphere all the way down to the deep sea. So we quantified for the first time the global abundance and fluxes of pollutants and the inputs into the ocean, about 200 species of persistent organic pollutants that we measured, both the inputs to the ocean but also the fate of those pollutants and the loads in plankton. And also we quantified the fluxes and the concentrations of many biogenic elements and also key greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide and also other important gases like oxygen, DMS, methane, and also the inputs of dust into the global ocean. We have also conducted the first global assessment of the loads, transport, and identity of the microorganisms that are transported by the atmosphere across the oceans. And we found that the loads are very dependent on the supply of microorganisms from land. So even small islands relay a lot of microbes into the atmosphere that can be transported across entire ocean basins. And we quantify the role of the ocean as a sink for microbes and fungi that are released from land masses, and quantify the suspension time, or the time that these organisms spend in the atmosphere, from anywhere between 1 and 4 days. And these suspension times are sufficient to transport organisms across distances up to 12,000 kilometers. So the atmosphere is an effective vector for the transport of microbes, and they can go across entire ocean basins suspended in the dust in the atmosphere. We, as I mentioned, sampled the top surface of the ocean, the skin of the ocean, with this Newton sampler, and we were looking at the propagules of organisms and eggs and planktonic larvae. But then this is also the area where plastic microplastics accumulate. So we completed the first global estimate of the load of floating plastic debris in the open ocean. And we validated model predictions that indicated that these areas in gray, which are the gyres of the ocean, are areas of accumulations of plastics. So microplastics accumulate in these 5 areas, of which there are 5 in the ocean, but the total load of plastic was less than 1% of the amount that we expected to find. And you might think that this is good news, but in fact it is disturbing news, because it means that we cannot account for the fate and the whereabouts of 99% of the plastic that entered the ocean. We don't know where that plastic is. And that is a matter that is now driving our work, and is one of the drivers of the Race for a Water expedition to find out what is the ultimate fate of this plastic. But we have evidence that this plastic is entering the food web through a particular class of fish that had not been very studied in the past, called mesopelagic fish. They are the ones that are living in the open ocean between about 300 and 700 meters depth. And in fact, one of the major discoveries of the expedition was also to find out what's hiding in something called the ocean deep scattering layer. So all the way from the development of echo sounders around World War II, then it was known that the oceans have a layer that is called the deep scattering layer at about 400 to 600 meters that is acoustically thick. So if you send a sound, then you receive an echo from this layer. And it was known that this layer contains living organisms, because they move up and down during day and night. So these organisms, many of them move up to the surface during the nighttime, and they go down and hide in the darkness during the daytime. So must be living creatures. But it was thought that these organisms were planktonic crustaceans and small animals, but in fact, we now know that they are mostly mesopelagic fish. And one of them is the lanternfish. You can see these organs that look like droplets, and they are able to produce fluorescent and light through these photophores, and they communicate through the production of light. So the lanternfish, the dragonfish, and all these small fish, they are what hides in this deep scattering layer all across the ocean and all ocean basins. So Xavier Irigoyen led the study of these fish, and along with colleagues here in KAUST, they quantified that the global biomass of these mesopelagic fish that had not been estimated before is huge. So we have revised upwards the total biomass of fish in the ocean by 26 times. And the good news here is that it's very difficult to catch these fish. So they have not been depleted by fishing vessels, because they cannot be caught. They have acute sensorial capabilities because of the large eyes of these organisms, and also sensorial capacities to detect pressure. So they can sense a net coming at about 50 to 100 meters in distance and move away from the pathway of this net. So the only way to quantify the abundance of these organisms is precisely using acoustic techniques. So it's a lot more fish in the ocean than we thought there were. And this particular ecosystem is still healthy and vibrant, because there's no way with present technology to catch these mesopelagic fish. We also went deeper down, all the way down to 4,000 meters across the ocean, which is the mean depth of the ocean. So the mean depth of the ocean is almost 4,000 meters depth. and the maximum is about 12,000 meters in depth. And in this depth of the ocean and dark layers, then we found one important surprise, and we found abundant and living and healthy photosynthetic organisms, which was a huge surprise. And we discovered, and that's a paper led by Professor Susana Agustí, that the sinking rates of these photosynthetic organisms into the depth of the ocean, which is a driver of the removal of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere into the deep sea, is far more efficient than we thought hereto. And one of the focus of the expedition that I share with the other colleagues that will talk tonight is about using the modern tools of genomics to explore the diversity of life in the ocean. So we collected microorganisms in filters, and then during many years we were busy sequencing these organisms to estimate the diversity of microorganisms in the ocean with a particular focus on the deep sea. So we are now working on the results from this effort, but basically we estimated for the first time the total number and diversity of species of planktonic microbes in the ocean. So bacteria and archaea have a very low number of species, about 5,000 species in the deep sea, and 50% of those correspond to unknown taxa, so taxa that are specialized in the deep sea. And many of them are very rare and occur just in a few water masses. We also estimated the total number of eukaryotes, microbial eukaryotes, in the deep ocean to be about 2,500. And again, most of them are known to science, and with a surprisingly high abundance of fungi in the deep sea, which was not really known until our expedition. We also discovered that the growth of bacteria in the deep sea is limited by the dilution of the organic substrates into thousands of compounds, each of them present in very low concentrations. And that's the reason why the deep sea has a pool of carbon that is the second largest pool of carbon in the planet, because the microbes cannot really access that carbon because it's much too dilute. And we are now focused on the description of the metabolic pathways and functions of genes in the deep sea, and we are estimating that probably we will come up with about 3 million new genes, which is about 78% of the genes that we find in these deep sea microbes. So by the end of the expedition, by 2015, we have just a few pieces of the mosaic that we'll compose when we have all of our results, a canvas of the state of the tropical ocean in 2011. And by 2015, we hope to have about 30% of the output that we envisage. And by 2025, then we will have, we hope, a coherent picture of the state and diversity of the ocean in 2011, as represented by our expedition. So in 2011, when we arrived home after 7 months sailing the oceans, Nature wrote a piece about our expedition with some comments from a highly prestigious scientist about the value of the expedition, but ultimately the success and the value of the expedition will rest on our findings. And we are only at 15% in exploring the results and the value of the samples we collected. But we have already achieved one of the goals, which was the outreach goals. We conducted public lectures in about 30 different nations. We have conducted exhibitions internationally and nationally about the ocean. We published comics, documentaries, radio, TV, newspaper stories about the ocean, a lot of artwork with drawings and photographs, web pages that have been massively accessed by the public, and also blogs, one of them by a Nature reporter that was on board of the vessel during one of the sailings between two harbors, and even cartoon movies. And we have not collected samples only for our own, and in the spirit of the expeditions of the illustration, then we're also thinking about building a legacy for future generations of scientists. So we have built a sample collection of all the different samples that we collected that is preserved and will be kept for about 15 years, so that a future generation of scientists, many of them that may be in the school in KAUST, can have access to a time capsule of how the ocean was in 2011. Because we ask ourselves, if we could reach back to scientists that circumnavigated the ocean in 2060 or 2007, what we will ask them to do for us. And what we would have asked them to do for us is to collect samples so we had some baselines of properties that we know now are important, but they could not be measured or there was no awareness of their importance at the time. So all of this was achieved with quite modest funding. And in fact, when I started thinking about this global expedition, out of frustration of the slow pace at which we were exploring the ocean, I was told that it was impossible. I was told that we were never given the ship time required to do this. I was told that my colleagues in Spain and internationally will never agree on the goals of the expedition. They will never even agree on the places that we will sail and take samples. And I was told that we will never be able to get the funding to do this. But the funding was quite modest and came along. And the total cost of the expedition, the direct cost of the expedition, was about 6.7 million plus the ship time. And these large research vessels are quite expensive to operate. So tentatively, you can estimate the total cost once you account for the in-kind cost and the cost of the research vessel in about 17 million euros for the whole expedition. So to put this in context, this boils down to about 4,000 euros per PI, per scientist, per year. And you can think about what can you do with 4,000 euros per year in terms of your own research, nothing. So this really highlighted the power of cooperation in being able to reach out to goals that are far more ambitious than those that we can achieve by ourselves. Then if you look at the total cost of the expedition in terms of direct and indirect costs, this is the same cost of 1 kilometer of building the fast bullet train that is going to link Medina and Mecca that is being built now around us in KAUST. 1 kilometer. And this train takes only about 10 seconds to transit this kilometer. So with the cost of 1 kilometer and 10 seconds of our time, we can actually take a major step forward in exploring the ocean and be able to assess its status and share with you what can we do to improve the status of the ocean, and that, again, the open ocean continues to be a healthy and vibrant ecosystem. And the impossible turned possible. For instance, one of our goals was to sequence microbes at the global scale. And in 2007, when we were planning the expedition, I was again told that it was impossible. It was impossible because at that time, the funding required would have been 500 million euros, which is 30 times the cost, the total cost of the expedition. We obviously didn't have that funding. We didn't have the sequencing platform, and even when we collected samples from the deep sea, the amount of DNA contained in those samples were 100 times less than that required to sequence the sample. So it was absolutely impossible. But I was counting on the evolution of the techniques and the technology, but also that the important element was to have the samples on hand. And between 2007, when we wrote the project, and 2014, when we completed the sequencing of the samples, then the cost of sequencing has fallen from $400 per million base pairs of DNA to only $0.1 per million base pairs of DNA. So this is 4,000 times, which is much faster than the Moore's law that looks at the reduction in cost of computing time. So again, it was impossible, but we did it, and it was impossible then. They were right, it was impossible. But in 5 years, the impossible turned possible. So I would like to close my introduction to the Malaspina expedition by looking at the science of impossible and how something that was impossible may well turn to be a leap in our understanding and exploration of the ocean, may catalyze future progress through the training of a new generation of scientists that are bold. They have a global approach to the problems of the ocean and the earth and to ocean research, and also to demonstrate the power of cooperation and collaborative approaches. So I would leave you with the thought that challenging the limits of the possible is important, and that the unlikely is not proven impossible until challenged. So you should also aim for the impossible. And after this introduction to the Malaspina expedition, I'd like to switch to the Tara Ocean expedition and invite the coordinator, Eric Arsenti, to come to the podium and walk you through the expedition. Thank you. here. Over to you.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay, thanks. Thanks, Carlos. We should stop this. Okay. This one, yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Carlos. Well, first I would like to thank Carlos and the whole team of the web for inviting me to come here. It's a real pleasure to be here and to present Tara Oceans. And also I am really glad to be in KAUST because many colleagues, I heard about KAUST through colleagues, but I never came here. So, and I must say I've been very impressed because it looks like it's a very interdisciplinary place, a very exciting lab actually, institute or place to work. So what, you know, this is interesting because Tara, I'm going to talk about Tara Oceans now. And in fact, Tara Oceans and Malaspina expeditions started almost at the same time. And there is a 1 year difference when we left, but it's almost the same time. And in fact, started from the same idea, you know, to redo a modern expedition around the world to study the oceans after all the expeditions that had been done like you heard in the previous presentation. So what we were interested in Tara Oceans was to actually explore also marine ecosystems and try to understand how they function, you know, how diverse, complex they are, how they function, and how they will be affected by climate change. So we did not do this expedition with a engine boat like Malaspina. We used a sailing boat, which was much smaller. So we could not sample deep sea, and we decided to sample mostly the surface, the deep chlorophyll maximum, and the mesopelagic, so down to 600 meters, but quite extensively, and in a very exhaustive way. So I just want to show you first, before starting, one movie to remind you what plankton is, actually. So this is a movie that has been made by Christian Sardet, one of the coordinators of Tara Oceans, and which will very simply tell you what plankton is.
Plankton comes from the Greek word planktos, which means wandering. Any living creature carried along by ocean currents is classified as plankton. It ranges in size from the tiniest virus to siphonophores, the longest animals in the world, and also includes microscopic algae, krill, or fish larvae. Some plankton, like these salps, drift all their lives. Others, like mollusks and fish, are only planktonic during their embryonic or larval state. When they reach adulthood, they settle or swim freely. Planktonic organisms play important roles in human life. Many microscopic species get their energy from photosynthesis. They absorb carbon dioxide and produce oxygen. Thus, they constantly renew the air we breathe. Plankton has also been a great provider of fossil energy. When it dies, it sinks to the seabed. This layer of sediment has fossilized for more than a billion years, producing our precious oil. Finally, plankton nourishes us. It's the basis of the food chain in which the large eat the small. Without plankton, there would be no fish.
Actually, we would not exist either. We would not exist because there are, you know, life started in the oceans about a little bit less than 4 billion years ago and evolved first in the oceans. And our ancestors are plankton organisms, and they still exist. Some of them are very ancient organisms, they still exist. So it's very important to know them. So the problem was that to try to understand these ecosystems, how they function, how they evolved, and how complex they are, is that if we want to understand this really, we have to characterize all the actors of this ecosystem, so the viruses, the bacteria, the protists, which are unicellular complex cells in the oceans, and the metazoans. And all these organisms make communities, they live together, they are dependent on each other. And in addition, the complexity of the system is strongly dependent also on many parameters, which are the environmental parameters, like temperature, salinity, light, depth, various parameters. So we needed, with a sailing boat of about 110 foot, to be able to collect all these organisms and try to separate them from each other a little bit in different size classes, and in the same time collect all these parameters to try to build databases that would allow to understand the complexity of the system and try to make models that predict that their behavior. So when I started this project, I thought the only way to make it to work was to collect a group of people who were specialists of different domains of plankton, so specialists of viruses, bacteria, protists, zooplankton, but also specialists of different types of technology that were needed to analyze the data, collect the data and the samples and analyze the data. So we needed to have sequencing power, people knowledgeable about environmental data, imaging data, data management, bioinformatics and modeling. So in fact, what is very interesting about the Terra Oceans project, I think, is that we managed to put a group of people, a little bit by, you know, exploring like this, that were specialists of different domains, very interdisciplinary and international. But these people planned the sampling, the data storage and analysis all together before we started and while we were doing the expedition. And I think this is what has been quite interesting in terms of scientific output afterwards. So the big difficulties, as I said, is that we had to sample all the different organisms. If you want to get enough viruses, bacteria, and small protists to do sequencing and imaging and quantitative imaging, you need to collect about 100 to 500 liters of seawater. So this is not too complex. You can just collect pump water. But if you want to quantify larger organisms, which are much less abundant than these ones, like the larger the organisms are, the less abundant they are. For example, there are something like 1 billion per liter of seawater. There is something like 1 billion of viruses and bacteria, but only 100,000 of medium-sized protists and about 10,000 larger size zooplankton organisms. So we needed to collect a lot of seawater for these organisms, and that therefore we use nets. So that we use different tools to collect the different organisms, but we generated different size fractions that we could analyze separately and then combine together to get a global picture of the whole system. In addition, you know, the oceans are not a just homogeneous water mass. It's very dynamic. So you see here a model of the global circulation, which is actually a real model. It's a realistic model. Which is at steady state, it's always behave more or less like this. So there are huge circulations in the oceans, gyres, big gyres, global regions like the Northern Atlantic, the Southern Atlantic, Northern and Southern Pacific, etc. And each area is a big gyre. For example, you have here the South Atlantic gyres. And some regions are very strange because there are currents that hit other currents, and this generates huge gyres like this. So if you want to understand, you know, how the ecosystems are organized in the pelagic global ocean, you need to plan the sampling properly according to what is known about oceanography. So that's what we did in Terra Oceans. This picture is not very nice, you don't see the continents here, but anyway, so. And we decided to go like this, so we sailed across the Mediterranean Sea, then the Red Sea, the South, the Indian Ocean, then the Atlantic Ocean here, Antarctica, then we sailed across the Southern and Northern Pacific, and finally we sailed across the North Pole in order to have a sample from almost all the oceans. But so, and in order to characterize the general gyres, but also specific regions in the oceans, which are either very acidic, more lack oxygen, or cold, warm waters, and so on. So this produced a lot of samples, which were from different water masses, allowing to do a very nice analysis of the global ecosystem. So we basically, it's more than this, we did something like 210 stations, we collected 30,000 samples for surface, TCM, and mesopelagic to do DNA and RNA sequencing, microscopy, and flow cytometry. And we had a lot of CTD profiles to characterize the water masses under our measurements, nutrients, chlorophyll samples, and carbonate samples to characterize the acidity of the oceans in different regions. So this is just like you saw before on in the Malaspina experiment. This is on Tara. But Tara is a sailing boat. So it's much, much smaller. We were about 14 people on board, six scientists, six sailors, usually one cameraman and one artist. And with this number of people, we had to do all, to do all the sampling I told you. So this shows you again, you know, how we worked on Tara, which is was quite a physical. You know, we use this to do sequencing afterwards. Okay, so this is a flowcam analysis of the samples, work on board. But basically, this is the same idea as what you saw before in the previous presentation. Okay, so now, The crucial thing was to develop a strategy. As Carlos said, when we started the expedition, we did not know whether we would be able to analyze the data because it was so expensive and it was not so easy to do the sequencing. But in fact, we planned anyway that we should, for the different size fractions, we should be able to sequence the RNA. So we prepared samples for DNA analysis and for RNA analysis to do metagenomics and metatranscriptomics analysis on the samples. And we also collected individual cells to do single cell genomes. So we already have sequenced something like 200 or 300 single genomes. And this is very important because we need to have these single genomes to anchor the metagenomics data. So this is a genomics. And we also decided for each size fraction to use different technology like flow cytometry for viruses and bacteria to quantify the organisms, high throughput microscopy that we are developing at EMBL to study protists, and the zooscan, which allows to quantify as well as the UVP in the stuck to the rosette to quantify the zooplankton. So the idea was to be able to quantify organisms from viruses to zooplankton, both using genomics and characterize the genes and imaging data, and at the end to combine both. Actually, we have not started to do this, but we want to do this. So the other aspect which is very difficult in expeditions like this is storage, integration, analysis, and modeling of the data. And you know, one big problem at the beginning of the expedition was the sequencing. But then the other problem was the computer power to be able to assemble the metagenomes, but also the storage of the data. And in fact, when we started the expedition, we would not have had the computing power and the storage capacity. So again, this was another bottleneck that became possible. But we had already taken, you know, started to work with EBI, EMBL, obviously, the Genoscope to do the sequencing, and Pangea. Pangea is an international oceanographic database, and EBI is obviously the database for genomics. So after a lot, you know, we started to sequence the samples, to analyze the data. We saturated basically the computing power of the CEA in France and EMBL for 3 months to do all this analysis. And then we published 5 papers about the complexity of the organisms in the oceans for viruses, bacteria, the initial analysis we could do for viruses, bacteria, and protists and eukaryotes, actually. And and among these papers, 2 of them were more dedicated to try to show how we could use this data to understand how these ecosystems function. So I'll just show you some data because so that you get a flavor of what the power of this kind of approach. So this is just, this shows you the analysis of the phages from, I think it was something like 40 stations, something like this. And this is, when you increase the number of samples, you look at the increasing number of genes you can characterize, and you see that it saturates at some point. So this means that we have almost completely characterized the gene complexity of the phages for the stations we have analyzed. And this corresponds to about 5,000 viral populations. And this corresponds to about 10% of Tara Ocean's data. So probably there is something like 50,000 populations of phages in the photic zone, if we extrapolate a little bit the whole thing. So another beautiful aspect of this is that because we know the global circulation, and we can compare the global diversity of viruses in all samples to the diversity we find in specific stations. And then we can see where how the diversity is determined by the generation of diversity from phage growth in different hosts in a given spot, and how these diffuses, these phages diffuse with are transported with currents, and how these generate the global picture of phage diversity in the ocean. So basically, we start to understand how local diversity of phages is produced, and how this local diversity is transformed into a global pattern of diversity in the Earth oceans. So this is the analysis of bacteria. So we using 68 stations, Pierre Bork and Shinji Sunagawa in EMBL have built a gene catalog, and we are using Tara Ocean's genes, GOS genes, other meta G, we find something like they could build 40 million a database of 40 million gene reference genomes, metagenomes, and they could organize this very well. So we can use this now to work and try to understand how what these genes are and how they function. In fact, the gene catalog again is close to saturation. This is 1,000 times more sequences than the global ocean sampling of the global ocean of Craig Venter, and this is 23,000 times more sequences than the human genome. So you see, I just show you this not to show that we did show big muscles, but it's just to show you the complexity of this, and how we could not have done this again 5 years ago. This was just impossible. Okay, so now the other kind. So this is just to show you, for example, for bacteria, what can we do with these samples? We can then start to see how the population, the composition of the ecosystems correlate with different parameters in the oceans. And what we find is that in fact the two major drivers of community compositions for bacteria are temperature and oxygen. Other parameters play a role, but the major drivers are temperature and oxygen. And this is very important in the context of global warming, because the ecosystem's structure will be strongly affected by the temperature changes. So again, this time it's the analysis of the eukaryotes, the larger organisms, between 0.8 and microns and a few millimeters. And again, we saturate. So this means, and this in this case, the complexity saturates for all the organisms from all sizes. The complexity saturates around 150,000 different types of organisms. So let's say genuses. So there is probably something like 1 million or more than 1 million species of eukaryotes in the oceans. Another interesting result of this is that when we compare the diversity of very small eukaryotes compared to the larger ones, the smaller ones are much more diverse than the bigger organisms. I will skip this, I think. Now, what is it? The other thing you can do with bioinformatics is to see who interacts with whom, and build these graphs. So to look at co-occurrence and exclusion. So we find that some organisms exclude each other completely, but in most cases, like in the oceans, 80% of the cases, the organisms coexist. And we can attribute this coexistence because we know which genes are present in the different types of organisms. We can attribute these co-occurrences to various reasons, like either it's symbiosis, or it's prey-predator relationships, or it's parasitism. And we can really start to understand, you know, how using this approach, how the interaction between organisms structure the ecosystems. So in order to go beyond that, we can compare the genomic data with imaging. So here you see, for example, a lot of protists, and we don't find a single protist almost that live alone. They always are associated either with symbionts or with parasites. So here you see, for example, diatom with many other small organisms outside that are symbiotic organisms. There are also various kinds of examples like this. Very, very nice. So I think I'll skip this part. So I just want to conclude. I think that what this expedition is starting to show is that cross-kingdom positive correlations dominate. So there are exclusions, so strong competition between some organisms, but in most cases, they need to be together in order to function. The environment seems to determine the emergence of a given type of community structure, but in fact, it's a combination of environmental parameters and plankton community structures that lead to the, together with transport, that lead to the self-organization of specific ecosystems. And in fact, these organized communities have important emergent functions in the food chain, obviously, but also in key geochemical processes and evolution. We usually think about evolution, you know, in terms of selection, largely in terms of selection. The problem is that selection, in fact, eliminates, you know, organisms, but the big problem is how you generate complexity, how complexity has been generated during evolution. And I think that, you know, interactions between organisms, in particular symbiosis, has been key. And having access to this large complexity of gene transfers, but also different types of interaction between organisms, can lead to a better understanding of how complexification of life occurred in the ocean. Now, the geochemical processes, it's also very important because a large part of carbon sequestration is caused by these organisms. And until now, we knew that specific organisms are connected with carbon sequestration, carbon export to the deep ocean. But what we can do now, and we have a paper in press right now in Nature that shows that we can really connect the flux of carbon towards the deep ocean with very specific networks of organisms' interactions, and even gene networks. So this is also a new way of approaching the system. So to finish, I just want to show you some movies too. Just like in Malaspina, you know, most of the time weather was nice, but there was a few legs that were very, very tough, like this one between Buenos Aires and Ushuaia. You know, this is the Roaring Fifties. And we have 3 weeks of this kind of weather, and we managed to do 5 sampling stations. So between low pressures, we just targeted the right place at the right time to be able to sample. And between 2 stations, we had this kind of weather. So we were thinking of these sailors, you know, like the Beagle and other sailing vessels that were going through these regions with much less sophisticated boats than this one. As in Malaspina, Tara Oceans has been very active in terms of communication with the public and with kids. So this shows you in each port of call, we got kids to come on board, and we explained them what we are doing. So in fact, it was not only the scientists who explained, but the sailors understood what we are doing. So it was a shared experience. It was very nice. Yeah, we were working with the sailors, taught the children. We worked also with the sailors together. And this was really just fantastic time. In addition to that, obviously, we did a lot of communication through the media, journals, and things like this. Okay, so I think this was in Ecuador, I think. Lots of people came on board. Okay, so, you know, again, we have been a lot of people. I just show a few pictures here of some of the people involved, but about 200 or 300 people took turn on Tara, and maybe more than that actually are now working on the analysis of the data. So thank you very much.
So to conclude, we will have a last presentation about a new expedition that is going to sail the ocean by Francis Van Vogel, which will be the Race for a Water expedition. And I need to get this in the screen there, please. Yeah. We go to the beginning. And we'll tell you about an entirely different class of a vessel that is now also sailing the ocean. So Francis, over to you.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, you must be all tired. It has been a long day. Many data. I'll be short. I want you, first of all, to relax, to stretch your legs. Just like me, to take a deep breath. And the second one. Okay. Now, one of these two breaths, whether it's the first or the second, it's up to you to choose. You have inhaled oxygen, which comes from phytoplankton. The other comes evidently from the trees and so on, but you cannot imagine how important the oxygen production is for phytoplankton. It's half the oxygen consumption, half the oxygen concentration of our planet. So as you can see, this is my first message. It's a short one, but it's an important one. The second message I want to make today is that seafaring in the 21st century is very important because besides having been in the past important for trade, having been important for tourism, today it's also something which is very important for understanding, developing new ideas, and trying to have a sustainable planet. That's the second statement I want to make. Why do we have to do this? We have to do this because seafaring in the 17th century, as we have seen today, was essentially geared at understanding the contours of land and trying from there then to explore the land in order to conquer this land as the humanity did later on. This is very different from a photograph in the 21st century where we have conquered all these areas. They all belong to us, but we have also polluted them to some extent. We have created something which is now a planet which is barely sustainable, and we have left aside so far 60% of the surface of the planet, which are the oceans, which are for us probably one of the ways to save the climate and save the planet in the future. Because, my friends, we have entered a new age. We have entered the new geological age, which is the age of Anthropocene. In fact, as you know, we can subdivide the life of our planet starting 5 billion years ago into different periods determined by geology, by climate, by asteroids, and by all kinds of other physical phenomena. But now things have changed, and the human activity has now affected the Earth so much that we have entered a new age. There is some dispute at the present time as to when this new age started, and there will be a conference in Norway this year which is going to try to define this. But certainly it's going to be more than 150 to 200 years. And I think it's up to us, it's a moral obligation. It is really a moral obligation of us as academics to redefine the act of living on our planet to avoid the sixth extinction. There have been 5 extinctions so far which have really wiped out the majority of life on this planet, the last one being the 5th extinction, which occurred about 55 or 60 million years ago, but that was due to an asteroid hitting an area probably around the Mexican Gulf and then changing completely the atmosphere. We were not really responsible for that, but we will be responsible for the next one if we don't do what we have to do. This is the reason why we got involved into the importance of oceans, pollution of oceans, and this is what's all about this interesting boat, which is called the Race for Water Solar Vessel. No mast, no sails, no propellers. How does this work? Well, hidden on the top, which I will show you in a second, hidden on the top are photovoltaic cells, solar cells, and these cells are really the necessary and give the necessary energy in order to this boat to advance. Now I have to try it. Can I get this done now? You probably have to help me because I have now another picture. Maybe I can do it here, right? Yeah, I'll do it here. Probably should. Yeah. Rather than describing what the circumnavigation of that boat was, I'll just show it through this short movie. It was built about 6 or 7 years ago, and at its surface, on top of it, as you see it on this picture here, you have solar energy, which is captured, electrons, which are just wiped off the materials beyond it, and then electrical current, which drives the boat around the world. It has started in Europe, it has moved then over to the United States. As you can see here, here it has deployed all its solar cells. There are some winches which help in order to expand them, or rather to contract them. Then you see here the solar vessel in Greece. And then we'll see this vessel has the necessary space in order to do all kinds of scientific experiments, essentially dealing with water pollution, as I will show you later on. The similar systems as you saw with my two predecessors. And besides this, it will also have, as we will see in a moment, an important role of awareness. We want to teach the young, we want to teach the next generation what we are trying to do and how they can help, because it's going to be their world and not ours anymore. So we have all kinds of, on this boat, all kinds of teaching sessions when they stop at various harbors when during the circumnavigation. This is also in Greece. Several universities in Europe have taken this boat also for scientific experiments, like the University of Geneva, but some other ones as well. And also in order to teach the young generation what it's all about, the interesting life in oceans and how we have to preserve it. Recognize the boat in London. Here in the Canal of Corinth in Greece. And the last few pictures will show the boat sailing up, it's not sailing, but going up the Seine in Paris during COP21. And I tell you, it's a very impressive thing to see this boat moving without, apparently without any energy, and just because the sun is shining. For me, it was just a unique experience. So let me show you now what this is all about. So as I tried to show you, it's a multi-purpose platform. We want to promote sustainability, innovation, because it's a solar boat. I'll be talking of the hydrogen in a second. Secondly, awareness. We want to educate. We want to show to the next generation and to our generation what we can do by saving the ocean. And it's also a scientific boat because we have been able so far also to accumulate a whole bunch of data regarding plastic pollution of the oceans. Here, a short fact sheet of the boat. The boat is about 23 meters wide, and it's about 30 and some 5 meters long. It has a speed, an average speed of five knots, which makes 9 kilometers an hour. It can speed up all the way to 14 knots, which is 26 kilometers an hour, and which is not very much. And it's really a problem because when the weather becomes bad, when there is a depression coming, the boat should be able to escape. At that speed, it's hard to escape. As you can see, the surface is about 512 square meters of photovoltaic cells, which transfer then the energy to lithium batteries. As you know, lithium batteries are not really the holy grail at the present time for stocking energy, but it's one of the better systems we have at the present time, which makes the boat quite heavy, as you can see, 8.5. And as you know, this has been the problem with Planet Solar, with the plane, which started to travel all around the world because those are very, very heavy batteries. But as shown here, the number of liters of gasoline used is zero. The CO2 emissions is also zero. So in that respect, it's very environment friendly. And I will also show you that at the average speed of the average consumption is 20 kilowatt, which is about 200 bulbs of 100 watts. So it's in that sense it's quite efficient. But we want to make it better with time. And at the present time, we're working with some technicians and engineers to add, to be able to stock more of our energy when the boat is at pier, and get that energy then fueling a electrolyte system. And with the electrolyzing system should produce hydrogen, which will be stocking in tanks, which will enable us then later on to use this hydrogen and increase the autonomy of the boat. At the present time, it's 72 hours, which is quite nice, but we want to double that. And at the same time, we want to make sure that the boat can speed up a little bit more so that when you have depression or bad weather, it can escape that bad weather more easily than it does at the present time. We should be there probably during this year, and with that boat, we will continue to do our exploration of the plastic pollution, because this is really our ultimate aim. The plastic pollution of the world is absolutely dramatic. Now, you have seen beaches like this. Eventually, people come and start to clean it up. I was lately at Cape Town also with another boat, and we had these beach cleaning parties. I tell you, it's after a whole day of work, your back is hurting, and the amount of plastic you have collected is not very high, but still, at least the beaches don't look that terrible as this image here. But at the present time, we know that 86% of the marine turtles, 44% of the marine birds, and mistake the plastic for the food and ingest this, which is really a dramatic problem. And at the present time, we also know that there are about 1 million marine birds which die every year from plastic ingestion, which is very, very dramatic. But there is more to that. There is more to that than the eye meets. The important problem is the conversion of the macroplastics into microplastics. And this occurs at a very high speed, and evidently we don't see it as well, but it's much more dramatic than the other part. If you want to follow me on the left side, I will walk you through this slide from top to bottom. You have this macroplastic as so shown here. Well, they are evidently very bad, as I showed you before, for marine mammals, turtles, and birds, which confuse this with food and take it in. But there is a physical-chemical degradation which goes on, and this is mostly due to waves, wearing and tearing because of the waves, but also due to UV degradation. UV degradation changes the physical quality of the plastics and ruptures them. There is a physical chemical degradation. And all this ends up with what is called microplastics. At this level, there is ingestion of birds. Here you see a stomach of a bird just full of plastic. Here you see a fish. So this is another way of contamination. If you go further down, then you go to the microplastic level, which is 0.5 centimeters and below. And here, what's really contaminated are the microorganisms, all kinds of plankton, as I showed before, phytoplankton producing oxygen, the second breath you took before. And all this is probably going to lead with time by ingestion of this material by human beings and contamination of the human food chain as well. So this is, those are really dramatic situation because it's hidden. People don't know much about it, but it's really accumulating at a very, very fast rate. And as Carlos showed you before, I mean, 90%, we still can, the amount of plastic which is thrown into the ocean at the present time is about 10 million tons a year. And evidently, this is not the amount which he found. He found just about 10% of that, and the other 90% we still have to show. They're probably in depth and probably transformed into microplastics. So let me now show you again a picture, the second movie. I'll start it from here.
50% of our planet's oxygen comes from the oceans and particularly plankton.
And I would like to share with you this wonderful dance found, which of block this wonderful systems. Plankton, which you're going to see in a second.
In the trees.
What a wonderful world. Whatever shape you can think of is present.
And that we did all the loving and separating.
So that's what we're dealing with at the present time. And this is this incredible diversity of plankton you can see which gets contaminated. And as I told you before, this is then ingested by all kinds of plankton. And you will see now the little green dots which you see here are microplastics, which is fluorescent, and how it's get ingested by the by plankton. See how it penetrates into the GI tract. It's like a trap. This is where science ends, and this is where questions have to be asked. And I'd like to walk through all these various questions, which to me are very important. Those are unanswered questions. We still don't know what the destination and the adverse effect in marine invertebrates are. We know that some of them are killed. We know that some of them have probably their metabolism is changed, but we don't have a clear analysis of all this at the present time. We don't know either whether the We don't know at the present time whether the shape, the size, the chemistry might have different impact on the diverse monocellular or pluricellular organism. We don't know whether the bioavailability is changing of the with time due to aging. You may know that a bottle of Coke, which is thrown into the ocean, has a lifespan of 850 years. So it has time to get degraded partly and then transformed into microplastics. We don't know either, and a very important problem, whether the plastics play, what kind of role they play as vectors for environmental pollutants. Most of the pollutants are organic compounds and therefore liposoluble and get stuck to these plastics and in fact increase, are concentrated on the plastics. And we don't know exactly yet what the migration from invertebrates is up the food chain all the way to us, and the estimation from local and in vitro studies to the global impact on ecosystems. So there's still a tremendous amount of scientific work to be done in this domain. I'd like to conclude by showing, I hope I've shown to you that seafaring in the 21st century is very important because it has an additional dimension, which is to promote sustainability through a better understanding of the oceans. I hope to have shown you that the race for water solar vessel has a unique platform to better understand the human impact on the oceans with this seafaring. And also that the plastic, as compared to geological periods, is rather new, but it's sometimes invisible, but therefore it's a major threat to the ocean biodiversity and ultimately to the human chain. And finally, for those of you who are interested in epistemology, I'd like to mention that, in fact, we are creating here a new science, which is called the sustainability science, and it's a unique opportunity for modern seafaring. Sustainability science has its origin probably about 15 or 20 years ago. It is a transdiscipline because it adds knowledge from social sciences, from biology, from medicine, from engineering, and it has a special focus. It has a very important focus, the interaction between humans, the environment, and our engineering system, which definitely have allowed us to have a fantastic development of humanity, but at the same time bear many potential complications as we see at the present time and are really hampering the future of humanity. And the sustainability science is epistemologically totally different from the other science because, in fact, it's not looking over disciplines, but it's based on problems to be solved. And then it unites all the various disciplines who might be helpful in that respect. I would like just to mention, this is a well-known phenomenon, which is the phenomenon of our understanding of the complex systems. And I think academics should now try to think rather than showing keeping the silo scientific approach in silo systems. They should try to think horizontally in order to understand these complex systems. I think the oceans is an ideal research domain for this. I'd like to end with this and hope that you will all help us to act towards a sustainable future. And I'll thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Francis. So Francis is not only a highly accomplished scientist, but he also prides himself of the accomplishments of his students. And there are particularly two students that he is very proud of, and they have played a role and play a role in KAUST. One of them is our Dean of BESI, Professor Pierre Magistretti, that was a former student of Francis, and also the former provost of KAUST. So he has had some influence also in training a generation of scientists at KAUST. So with this, it's been a very long session, so we are running out of time, but I'd like to offer the opportunity for you to address our guests with maybe a couple of questions before we come to our closure. So if there are any questions, please raise your hand, and there are a couple of microphones on the room.
This one, all of it.
Ah, okay.
Thank you very much for very interesting presentations. I just have a question. As we know, in 2011, there was a big earthquake in Japan, and this produced a big tsunami, which damaged the Fukushima Daiichi power plant. Since then, a lot of water contaminated with radioactivity is pouring into the Pacific Ocean. So what are the consequences of this water in the ocean? And I mean, will we have a direct impact, or, I mean, what can you tell us about?
Yeah, so in fact, I can take on that question because at that time we were sailing the Pacific. And when we were in Australia, the accident took place and the tsunami that triggered took place. And then we very quickly fitted up to collect samples to assess the transport of radioactivity and pollution through the atmosphere, but also to look at the position rates in the plankton. And through our transit between Australia, New Zealand, and Hawaii, we were unable to detect levels of radioactivity above the background. But some colleagues of ours have been looking at radioactivity pollution around Fukushima. Unfortunately, the power plant was located in a place with huge dilution capacity. So today, the levels of radioactivity in fish around Fukushima, despite the fact that the radioactivity continues to be released in the ocean, is actually no more than you can get when you ingest a banana. So the ocean also has huge dilution capacity, but not everywhere. So when planning this type of facilities that require cooling, an intake of seawater to cool, for instance, power plants, but also desalination plants required water as an input, then we must be very careful in understanding the drivers and the physical dynamics of the places to be able to assess the dilution power of that particular location. So that was fortunate in the case of Fukushima, but it is not an universal trait that they have been very well located in terms of the dilution of the ocean. So maybe if there's another question in the room, we can address that. And else, so, oh, there's one more, Pierre. So that's obviously a question for Francis.
Must be. Well, actually, yes, but I think all of you can answer. The numbers concerning plastic pollution are absolutely scary. And so what actions can be taken? Obviously, one is stop using plastic, two, try to clean up. But is there any hope that there is actually more proactive intervention to get rid of what is already there other than cleaning up? Because it's really scary.
Okay, I'll take on this question first of all because you know when Jordine was a student, I would ask the difficult questions and he will have to answer them. That was just the reverse. the plastic pollution is absolutely, as you say, it's absolutely incredible. Now, what's in our opinion, what's in the water, what's in the ocean at the present time is lost. And I mean, it's lost for humanity. It's going to stay there, and it's going to stay there for a long, long time. There's some evidence that because of the gyri and the circular movement of water, some of this plastic goes to the bottom. Plastics have densities, some of them a little bit above one and the other ones below one. Those below one are probably sinking with time. The other ones probably remain at the surface. We have not the slightest idea, maybe my colleagues have one, but not the slightest idea at the present time about nanoparticles. Does this get degraded with time with a lot of nanoparticles? We don't know this. The only thing which we can do at the present time is to legislations and recommendations as to the production of plastics and the usage of plastics. There are a whole bunch now of countries which are starting to address this problem, but I think we have to be careful because it's a race against time. The production of plastic per year is in the range of 280 to 300 million tons. 10% of this ends up in the oceans through the rivers of by other systems. There are now some interesting machines, or I don't know how to call them, which take the plastic and compact it, and then under low pressure, absence of oxygen, it's not burning anymore, but that's just break down the covalent bonds to make small products out of it. What's coming out of this? It's either oil or gas. I visited such a plant in Cape Town lately, which didn't convince me very much. I saw lately another one in Zurich, which is very impressive. You just feed whatever you want to feed with the machine, and then under low pressure and the absence of oxygen, what's coming out is methane gas at the other end, which evidently you have to capture and use it as such. So I think those are the two options which I see at the present time, and legal and industrial, to make sure that the contamination of the water stops. Mm-hmm. We have little data. I think there's some data now accumulating regarding lake pollution. There is a study which came out of Switzerland lately, which showed that all the lakes are also polluted. So and as I said before, what strikes me is that people think of plastic just as plastic pollution of the beaches or along the roadside. But I think what's much more important is the plastic pollution when it's broken down into small pieces because we don't see it anymore. And that's really entering the food chain, and we'll probably have our children will have this problem in the future.
Yeah. So I invite you also to Google Time's Disposable Life. And in the 1960s, Time magazine published an issue with a cover page called Disposable Life, where you had some housewife and a house husband throwing away happily disposable plates and silverware and so made of plastic. And it was celebrated as being the step towards liberating women from having to have to wash things on the kitchen. So this disposable life that was supposed to be a milestone in the development of a modern life is now a curse that we have to live with. But there's some important steps that are happening. One of them is a search, well, awareness, of course. And today, I think you can, in the spine, in front of the library, you can see a very large mass, which is a sample of the disposable water bottles that are used in the campus dinner in 1 week. So that makes you aware of how much plastic we at KAUST generate. And we have a campus sustainability program, so we need to also participate and think about how can we avoid using that much plastic ourselves. And there's also an important initiative in the web of the bracelet challenge, so you can take a bracelet and wear the bracelet in one arm if you are not using disposable items, and then if you happen to use them, then you change it. And by the time you are able to undergo 2 weeks without having to change the bracelet, then you have already built the skills in being able to do about your daily life without using disposable plastics. And it's really these disposable plastics that are the core of the program, the problem where we should intervene, because the mean usage of this plastic is just a few minutes. So from the time we purchase the item in the market to the time we dispose of it, it's just a few minutes. So there's some other plastic elements that we can use for years, and that maybe is not so much of the problem, but it's the short-lived disposable plastic that are making the bulk of the litter we produce. But we at KAUST are engaged in different research projects. One of them is a project in computing science to be able to very quickly and rapidly automate the classification of plastic, so we know the origin and of marine plastic pollution. That is led by Professor Xianliang Zhang from computer science starting this year. And also we are looking into polymers of marine origins. Mm-hmm. So we're looking into developing polymers from macroalgae and seaweed that can be used to replace and displace the plastic produced from oil. So there's some steps that we can do, but the most important one is to be aware of how can we live lives that are more gentle to the planet and therefore also making ourselves a service. So sometimes people get quite worried when they realize that the plastic pollution goes into the food web, and perhaps if you have a fish dinner tonight, there might be some microplastic in the fish that you are eating tonight. But that's just a pale mirror image of what we do at home, because we choose to wrap our food in plastic. So when we walk out of the supermarket, all of our food is wrapped in plastic because of our choice. So the amount of plastic we may ingest with the marine food web is nothing compared to that we ingest because we just happen to wrap up all of our food in plastic. When we take it from the supermarket, when we store it in our fridges, and also when we take it to work. So think about what you do every day, and that's probably the best solution. So with this, I'd like to thank you all for your time and patience in bearing with this very long session tonight. And also, I'd like to thank, as a token of appreciation, our guests tonight with two...
plastic bags.
Items, no plastic bags, paper bags. And these are reproductions of our iconic beacon of KAUST. So this is...
Oh, that's beautiful.
For you.
Beautiful, thank
yes.
you.
Thank you.
Yes. And
thank you very much. This is
thank
really
you,
beautiful.
Francis, and
thank
you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.